If there's something that you have here that feels like really snuggly and you'd be super comfortable having it, like bringing it into the nest, like in the things case or whatever their name are, you can feel free to bring them, like a snuggly blanket or like your favorite pillow or whatever you might have around, because that will add to our nesting. Okay.
Josh, do you want me to introduce you?
Yes.
I'm not going to
have to. Hi, everybody. I think we're going to get started. Okay. There once was a creature named Josh Halpern. And he lived in a big house with a lot of plants and nice colors and little trinkets and decorations. And there once was a person, creature named Lily Falconer, who joined a graduate program and didn't feel that she belonged. But then she came to Esalen and she met this other creature, Josh, and he made her feel so welcome.
Oh, good. That's good.
And I'm just having a really emotional day today, so that's why I like look like I'm crying, but it's not just because I love Josh so much, but I do love Josh so much.
It's okay.
And
can include everything in the next.
Yeah, everything's here. And Josh is just such an amazing human creature being. And such an amazing friend, and such an amazing collaborator, and educator, and musician, and word maker upper, and honey distributor, honey guy. And he makes a killer Laniakea. I mean, come on, you guys. I'm just so excited to have Josh be closing out our 2016 PCC Esalen retreat. This was something that, as putting together the schedule, I was really excited to have him close us out. We can hear you guys. And I want to also say that right after this, just really quickly, out the back door, there's going to be a little optional prayer and intention setting for the upcoming election, as we are going to be reintegrating back into that other place with all that stuff. And now I just really want to welcome someone who's doing something with the camera. Oh, he studied film at NYU.
That's true.
And he has a master's in PCC. And a doctorate in just being a really good person.
Oh.
Yeah, like highest honors.
Earned it.
And so just please welcome Josh.
Thanks, everybody. Welcome to our nest. Much appreciated that you came and joined us here today at the last workshop of our little time together here. I want you all to be comfortable and cozy. I'm going to offer the possibilities of touching each other and ourselves a little bit, sniffing, using our different senses, but all of that is completely voluntary, of course. some of us are more comfortable with our own stank than others, so feel free to honor your own bodies and your body's needs. And that's what this is about, primarily. I have worked a lot with the idea of home. It was the Integral Ecology track that brought me in. And I've come to understand home and homemaking and all the ways that we come together to agree upon what our home is as occurring at multiple scales, occurring at multiple time frames, and all very relational and very embedded. Nested. And we've heard that theme a couple of times. We heard it in Carrie's talk about nested harmonies of vibration and time, and we heard it in Charles Eisenstein. There's been a number of people who kind of touch on this, and I'm drawing from real lineages as well as just feeling into what we seem to be within and participating in. I have a couple things in the center of our nest, which you feel free to look at any time. This is a series of nesting blocks. So if anybody wants to build a thing like that, you can. And it lines up. See, on that side, there's a tree and a deer and stuff. Yeah. So anybody, feel free to sneak over here. This is Laniakea, which I'll get to. And I could have put a lot of different things that I could be like, and that's a nest, and oh, that's a nest too, but I don't, you know, want to be too far down that road because we would never come back. So I'll talk a little bit about nests as we encounter them in the world, because there aren't really, there aren't really a kind of creature on the planet that doesn't nest. I mean, there are individuals that don't nest, but across all of the animal groups that we know, insects and amphibians and mammals and birds and fish, there's lots of different kinds of nests. And I have a couple of like crazy facts about them. The nests with the largest amount of individuals are insects and also prairie dogs. You can have prairie dog nests with 400 million individual prairie dogs. That one covers, I forget where it is, but it covers 25,000 square miles.
What?
Like a lot, it's in the Badlands? Uh-huh, thank you. Yeah, what? Exactly, exactly. There's bird nests that are 33 feet high and 100 feet wide. The most common materials used for nests are plant materials, but you can also use mud and feathers and poop. And there are certain animals that like secrete a special thing from their kidneys that is the perfect glue for the exact ingredients that they need in their nests. And what I want to do, I'll just finish with fish and amphibians use jelly nests or bubble nests. So you can find nests just about everywhere. And I'd like to add a few more ideas about nests in this talk today, if possible. Let me first play in this. This image. This image here I took last night. It's the Moon and Venus and Saturn right out there. And this dance dome is a bit of a nest. And Esalen and the tubs are a bit of a nest. There's a couple pictures from Esalen from our time here today, but most of these I found online. And some of them are from my workshop 2 years ago on Holobiont bodies, which I'll get into. But some of them are just like new, awesome, weird nests and things that look similar to each other, but on entirely different scales. And I'm just gonna play it and let it roll, and it can just be playing in the background. And if you see anything that's particularly astonishing, you know, call out and we can talk about it. I'm very open for people to share their own, you know, experiences with all that. Okay, so. I didn't take that one, though. But that's just down the road, right? No, I didn't take that one either. I mean, you know. So, thank you. Okay, let's drop into our bodies. We're gonna start there. I'm gonna do a couple of the sort of body tuning ins that we did last year. So everybody close your eyes and breathe. Maybe time your breath a little bit with the ocean. So maybe do a all safe here in this nest. But there still may be places in our bodies that have pain or sadness, grief or frustration. And if you have a place like that in your body, you can send it some love, because I'm sure it would appreciate that. So just focus on that part of your body and send mercy and healing into that space. And then imagine that you're at the front door of your house and you walk out about, you know, 5 feet, 10 feet into the middle of your street and pivot slowly 360 degrees and take in, just in your vision there, and you're using all your senses, all the diversity of individuals that live around you, both in terms of the humans there, the different cultures and kinds of people that live around you, also the different kinds of trees and plant beings, also the different kinds of animals. Maybe there's a bunch of squirrels, maybe there's some birds, maybe you're lucky and you have larger animals and deeper relationships. Even if you don't know some of them, they're still there, like having their own amazing lives right nestled right around us all the time. As our final little meditation before we get a little bit more deeper into our bodies, remember what you had for lunch? There was that pesto sandwich. So if you had that sandwich, that sandwich included grains, and you could imagine the grains swaying in the wind with their tall stalks and their long, little dangly bits, technically termed there. And then the basil plant, right, which has those big, bright green leaves that you can kind of pluck them, and they're so fat and kind of crisp and refreshing. And then there was brie, if you took the dairy or glutinous one. And I think brie usually comes from a cow, yeah? So there's a cow. There's our cow. And all the individuals that milked the cow and harvested the wheat and plucked those basils, and all the rain and the soil that was involved to go into that meal, and all the work that was done here at Esalen. And then also the question of where is that sandwich now? Is it here? Has it gotten to this part of your body? Has it gotten around, winding around? Is it there already, or is it still kind of up here, down here? It depends. We all have our own metabolisms. And we all, one of the things that makes us the most unique is our inner flora, our complex characters, which outnumber us by vast astronomical numbers in terms of the mass and the genetic makeup of our bodies. So there are 100 trillion microorganisms in our gut. And it's so, and on our skin and in our hair, between our, you know, toes. If you're near somebody and you want to link up toes or tuck a thing under an armpit and give us a little whiff. Because they're fine, you can work up to it if you want. The point being that there's a very big difference between the sort of dry butte of your elbow and everybody that lives there, and the sort of warm rainforest of your armpit, and the oily, you know, forehead beings, and all the sort of fungals in between each of your toes. And we need all of those. We couldn't survive without all of those. As soon as we die, a lot of those start eating us. Because they switch off from the, it's what your death feeds. It's an important question. But currently, while we're alive, it's like 10 to 1 in terms of mass. Like most of our mass is these beings that we carry around. And it's 100 to 1 of the genetic material that we walk around with all the time. the genetic material that we exist with, 100 to 1 of it is those tiny beings' genetic material, not our human, without them, it's just a little bit of us. With them, it's a whole human holobiont.
I heard we house bacteria to the 10th power.
To the 10th power? Yeah, yeah.
And our mitochondria is a different DNA.
Right. See, exactly.
We can't live without them?
No, we can't live without them. And they are extremely important for all of the various functionings that we have to do in order to be humans. Now, the words I just used, holobiont, that's a Lynn Margulies term. And she was using it in reference to coral reefs being bodies made up of other bodies. And so what I'm, to my understanding, humans are also that. Holobiont. Holobiont. Holobionts, but holobionts, I think it would be a decent pronunciation. The title of this talk is From Our Guts to Our Gardens to Our Galaxies. So my idea that we're exploring today is that these are all holobiont bodies, that we are embedded within larger bodies, that there are bodies embedded within us, and that keeps going on and on, up and down and in all directions. So one of the things that I want to explore that seems pretty important to me, just as a embodied person, that's the nest, yeah. I had to put one of those in. And then I think it'll start, yeah, good, okay. I want to be in cahoots with all of these beings with which we're sharing bodies. Because I know personally, my gut and my heart and my brain and all the various parts of me are not always working for the same goals. I have lots of intentions that I'm using with my head or with other parts of my body, my heart maybe, but I have to poop first before I get started on any of that. And sometimes I'm late to things because of that, you know? So just as a, you know, practical matter, it would be good to be able to work that out. And I'll talk a little bit about ways that that might happen. But one of the fundamental ways that we carry messages through our bodies seems to be the vagus nerve. Do you guys know about the vagus nerve? A little bit, somewhat. I'm just learning about it more, so anybody who knows about it more than me, give me, I mean, for instance, somebody was like, I think it's vagus with like a hard A, not vagus. I was like, yeah, that's like you. That was you. I was like anus. I'm open to complicated pronunciations, but I also want to get it right. So the vagus nerve is vagus means wanderer, and that's because it's what connects our, it starts behind the eyes, it's in charge of like the dilation of our pupils, and it goes back behind our throat, so it's in charge of speech and swallowing and gag reflex, and then it comes back down and hits a couple parts of our throat and our heart, and is in charge of certain ways of pumping. So when we take an in-breath, it's our heart running the show during that in-breath, so we're also ready for fight or flight in that moment, you know? And then in the exhale, that's the vagus nerve that takes over, and that's the parasympathetic side of things, so that's resting and digestion. And if it's connected to all of these parts, if you're expressing terror, if I go, then you might go, and what we've communicated there behind our vagus nerve is like we're not safe in the nest. We got to get out of here. But if we're then maybe we're safe. We can do what we came here to do, or do nothing, depending on what we're into.
And Meg Jordan at CIS IHS talks about like the vagus as in like vagal tone.
Yeah.
Like, it shows how you. For example, like responses have been encoded in the vagal tone, can be the quality of that response, and if we've had a containership in our lives to help us develop like a healthy, strong vagal tone.
Right, yeah, exactly. And there's different things that you can do to activate your vagus nerve. One of the things, I have some orange slice, it's not orange, lemon, haha. If anybody wants to take a little lemon slice. Just even thinking about the lemon might get your gland, your salivary glands starting to go. But if you actually take the lemon, or even better, you drip the lemon into some water, Gesundheit. And gargle with it, like really, that's gonna get things really like going there. And there's meditations you can do, there's massages. So if anybody feels comfortable and wants to reach your arms out to your neighbor and massage this part behind their ear like that. Also, you may self-massage if that's better. Like this. That's just what you thought, that's what you went to intuitively, huh? Sort of behind the ear and down, Lenore. Gently, but a little bit, sort of, just sort of sliding down. Sliding down like that, yeah, yeah. That will go, oh, I think maybe it's okay to just be like that. And there's, so this seems to have great deal of effect on mood, on inflammation. There's, we can keep work on it. Yeah. It's okay. We don't have to solve all the vagus situations in one neck touch. So there's a lot of things that are affected in this way. And we're going to get a little bit more into some of the epigenetic aspects too. This is a great book I've been reading. It didn't start with you. And it's about the way that our ancestral experiences, what our parents went through and what their parents went through, affects what we go through in our lifetimes because of how the DNA is formed in the womb of our mother and our grandmother, and the experiences that they went to sort of setting them up for and their descendants up for the same kind of, if they didn't have food, then there's a scarcity consciousness there. If they were, for instance, in a war situation or in a massacre situation, then there's a lot of trauma that can be passed down. And I think maybe some of us have some experience with, like, why am I so worked up about this, even though I've never been through an experience like that? And some of this work with the vagus nerve, where we can open up that channel of communication so that they're all kind of talking to each other. And some of, there's research around diet affecting epigenetics as well in our lifetime, so that even if we inherit some of the ways that the DNA has been methylized, I guess, is what happens. There's ways that diet can adjust those methylization. And I'll get to some examples of that a little bit later when we talk about gardens. Yes.
Hi.
I didn't mean to scare you. That's okay. Yeah, I feel it was a heart response, but now that I see you, my vagus is turning. Yeah.
I wanted to share a little bit about what I know about.
Great. Yeah, please.
And because I find this so useful, and it may be useful to you all in your class. Any of you who practice yoga and know about ujjayi breathing, that stimulates the vagus nerve and calms. And if you're not familiar with ujjayi breathing, it's a kind of breathing, conscious breathing that you do where you kind of try to close the back of your throat a little bit and make a whisper sound, almost like a Darth Vader sound. If you do that, it really it takes concentration, so it focuses your mind. It slows down your breathing. It's easier, in my experience, to get the whisper sound on the exhale, but trying to get it on the inhale, too, can really have profound effects, and it's incredibly calming and linking the head and the heart. So I commend that practice.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
It's called ujjayi.
Ujjayi, and it's like you hear.
Yeah.
It's like you hear the ocean.
Yeah, it sounds like ocean
waves
too.
So, I'll touch one more aspect of our inner landscape, and then we'll expand out a bit in scale. I also have noticed over the course of my, you know, being in therapy and being here and working in relationship, that I have a lot of voices in my head vying for attention and command of the narrative and the stories that I work with. And some of them are pretty grim or dreading things or discouraging. Some of them are very calm. Some of them are very ridiculous. Some of them are in deep pain. Some of them are in torment. Some of them are always trying to sort of insist on something, and some of them are really shy. And so one of the things that I've been trying to do is cultivate a council of all those voices. When I, and, you know, there's different ways that that can show up. I've done like an animal chakra totem, where there's an animal that lives at each chakra, and they can change and they can adjust. And also, you know, that might look differently for all of you, but just the more that the different parts of you are honored and respected, even if they're hurting or struggling, that can make a difference for the whole rest of the being. So you've probably noticed that some of these are not just human scale or microscopic scale or animal scale, but some of these images are bigger. So we're gonna zoom out. So we have our bodies, and our bodies emerge from and ultimately return to a planetary body, which feels very large to us, but is sort of a medium small planet as rocky wet planets go. And our planet is part of a solar family. And that solar family is moving through a great grand spinning galaxy. And that galaxy, as you've probably seen from some of these images, it looks pretty nest-like, actually, because it's kind of circular and holding all of this life within it. There are also nebulae, which are actual hatcheries for stars, nurseries. Once you even get bigger than that, you start getting into superclusters of galaxies. And I am dressed as one now. I'll have a different costume later for the dance party, but currently I'm dressed as Laniakea, and Laniakea was just recognized about 2 years ago. So we have a couple of older maps. This is one of the newest maps and the largest maps of where we live. And Laniakea is 100,000 galaxies, like which our Milky Way is one of. And our Milky Way has its own trillion suns, and each sun probably has a planet. So just to give a scale like that. And Laniakea, these are 100,000 galaxies. If you want to pass this around, this is Laniakea, just be careful. The Milky Way is in the exact center of this cube. And there are two starsheds. There's Laniakea, which is the bigger one, and then the Perseus-Pisces starshed is on the other side, and they're flowing away from each other. So if you were here for the gender talk at the beginning, Will, right, was likening this to a heart, because it looks like two aorta halves. I was originally feeling like maybe they were in a cosmic dance. It looks like mitosis occurring on a giant, giant, giant scale. And so one starshed is 100,000 galaxies flowing to this point, which is called the Great Attractor, like we know anything about it. And it's an area of dense mass in the universe that is so dense it can attract all of these different galaxies. The other starshed is flowing to that point. And I don't know what they're doing. If any of y'all have some senses of what they're up to, that's us. So, you know, one of the interesting things that I've been sensing around that is we are not near the center of the supercluster, the great grand being of light that's dancing in the sky around us. We are out at the very, that's why I have this ring on, we are out at the very fingertip. And the heart, with which all the galaxies are rushing towards, is here. And so I have a question of, is it possible that one of the reasons that we feel so isolated and alone and, you know, everybody against each other is because we don't see all our neighbors surrounding us all the time? That if we lived in a place where there was a lot more light and a lot more life, obviously apparent in the sky around us, we wouldn't have any misunderstanding that we were alone, that we would be, that we would consider ourselves isolated. Yeah, what does it look like?
Looks like a brain.
Like a brain. Might be a brain. Yeah, well, and that leads me to my next question, which is how aware is Laniakea of themselves? How aware are they of us and being covered in light and life and being made up of all of us as beings within the larger being? There's a researcher, I forget his name, I can look it up and let you know, who was looking into stellar consciousness and if there's a way that the movement of the stars through the galaxy is actually designed by the star to pass through certain parts of the galaxy, to be able to use certain elements, because these nebula, there's two different kinds of nests. You either sculpt a nest out of materials that are already there, or you bring, it's either sculpting or assembly. So in the case of interstellar space, you have a whole bunch of hydrogen, you have helium, you have dust, you have H2O, and when it starts collapsing and coalescing, that's when you start getting things like stars and galaxies and planetary beings. So I don't quite know if a galaxy is sculpting out of the dark matter, or if it's assembling out of the elements that we can see with the naked eye. It might be a combination of both. Certainly, they've shown that a good amount of the water on the planet predates the solar system, because it's available before the sun was formed and drew in to form these planets. And water exists all over the solar system, that we're finding out more and more. So I love that sense of, like, sometimes when you tell people this, it reaffirms that they're totally insignificant in the vast, meaningless universe. And what I tend to feel is the opposite, that we are at a very important scale, a very unique scale, where we're able to zoom in and out, where we're able to look teeny and big, and be able, I mean, one of the troubles is we have all of these resources in our planetary nest, which we use completely to our own benefit. We make the world to fit our hands and our butts and our feet. And then that at the sacrifice of anybody else with other kinds of butts and hands and feet. So we want to be aware of who we're including in our nest, right? So that can bring us back, jump, to the Earth. Because as all of you know, or you wouldn't be in this program, there's a great deal of changes happening on the planet right now, right? And we're not caring for our nests with the idea that there are more of us in here. We're caring for our nests in a way that it's only about me. One of the ways that I've been blessed and humbled to be able to be available with these questions is in the worlds of local food and food justice. That's my background, and I've been working for a local bee farm and selling honey at farmers markets, and I can say a little bit more about the bees in a second. But I've also been working this last year as a garden teacher for an elementary school. And that's one of the most, 5 minutes, great, that's perfect. That's one of the most profound ways I've ever experienced to be able to engage with the seasons and the exact sort of shifts from when the pomegranates end but the persimmons are still going and the pineapple guava are just starting to come on, and as the pineapple guavas get to like the three-quarter point of their season, the lemons and even the oranges might start up, and then we get the blueberries as the first berries that come in the spring, and just sort of honoring all those shifts, right?
And I didn't have anything like that growing up. I was not raised with that kind of awareness. I had to find it later. But these kids, they're going to be in love with this planet, loving running up to a bush and being able to eat all the inside-out berries that they possibly can, right? And if you're already established in a loving relationship with the planet, then you're much more likely to care about it, to fight for it if it's struggling, to honor those relationships throughout your life. If you don't get that at the beginning, there's not much to convince you that it matters if you're just stuck in a screened world, right? Also with the bees, and getting back to the epigenetic dietary aspects, one of the amazing things about the queen bees is that
the reason that you have a queen bee is because of what it's fed.
Jelly, which is a unique secretion from certain bees. And queen bee is fed royal jelly its whole life, and that allows it to do its her queen bee-ness. So her body gets longer, she's in charge of running the whole show, you know, laying eggs, fighting other queens that might want to show up, doing the complicated bee mating dance in the sky. And that's a direct way that diet shifts that bee's DNA in order to be a unique, special bee. And there's evidence that there are foods that we can eat to shift our DNA in our lifetime, to turmeric being a very very useful across the board in terms of inflammation, but also in terms of anti-cancer, things like folic acid, B vitamins, the SAMe nutrients, and there's a growing genomics field that is super interesting. And there's also foods that can affect your vagus nerve. There's probiotics for your gut, and lots of ways that you can tune into. Okay, if I'm experiencing Esalen tummy because I've been gorging on all the delicious foods, then there might be ways to bring consciousness into the different parts of your body. Exactly. No, it's great. I'm all for the sounds that come out of our bodies too. They are good clues for what's happening as well. And also taking honey can help with seasonal allergies for us, because it's the same pollens in the air, and you take at least a tablespoon a day, your body gets used to the pollen and you stop sneezing. It takes like a day or two, and it's a big difference. So I'll just end, and I appreciate you spending time with me like this, and I'm looking forward to, hopefully we'll catch the last bit of sunset. There's a lot of trouble in the culture. Speaking of the election, that's writ large across all the shadow and disgusting, hate-filled rape culture that's coming out in this election, as it turns out. And one of the things that can help most deeply with that is like a nurturance culture. And I've seen that this week with all of us, where we take care of each other, where we're more than in cahoots, we're really in solidarity with one another. And I like this idea of the nest because it has a sense of who's in our nest and who's still out of it, and what is the scope of who we feel like we include as our home, as our comrades, as our compañeros. And within that orientation, we can keep making our home, co-creating our homes together. I guess it's time to leave the nest. If you're all comfortable with your rearing thus far, you can like peek out on the branch a little bit. You can stretch your wings a little bit, you know. Kick your brothers and sisters out before they're ready. And thank you so much.
Can I eat that?
You can eat that.